Hi, good morning friends. Today we will discuss about the Pelton wheel and Pelton wheel. What is a Pelton wheel? What is the parts of Pelton wheel? What is the working function of Pelton wheel? Means what is the working principle of Pelton wheel? What is the design proportions of Pelton wheel? Okay, let us start our class. So this is a Pelton wheel layout diagram. So I will explain the parts of the Pelton wheel. This is a penstock. This is coming from the reservoir or dam, and this end of this penstock we will attach a nozzle. Nozzle is nothing but a reducing cross sectional or convergent section of any shape is called a nozzle. It means gradually the diameter is area is decreased. This is called nozzle, means the reducing cross section shape of a device is called nozzle. This is a nozzle. This is called also called as a convergent shape. Okay, this is a penstock. At the end of penstock we connected a nozzle. So from the nozzle a jet of water is coming from the nozzle with a high velocity. The purpose of nozzle is to increase the kinetic energy. By whenever the area is cross section area decreases, according to continuity equation, area into velocity for maintaining the same discharge. Whenever area is decreases, velocity increases. That means kinetic energy increases. Means from the nozzle, the jet of water is issuing and strikes on a cupped or bucket shape or double hemispherical shape of bucket. It strikes bucket of a wheel. So this is a bucket. All these buckets are equally spaced on a runner, the outer periphery of a runner. Runner is also nothing but a wheel. So this is a wheel or runner. This is a spear wall. This is a spear for controlling of the discharge or flow rate of water from the nozzle. This is a brake nozzle. These are the parts. So coming to the working principle, what is a Pelton wheel? Pelton wheel is nothing but it is a tangential flow impulse turbine. This is a tangential flow impulse turbine in which the high potential energy coming from the reservoir or dam is converted into the kinetic energy at the nozzle. So here the dam is around in Pelton wheel, around the height of the nozzle, height of the system is from reservoir to Pelton wheel is around about 250 meters. So means the center line of the nozzle to the headrace means dam height or reservoir height is about 250 meters. So here whenever the height is a high altitude is there, there is a potential energy. Here the potential energy gradually increases from higher to lower. At the end of penstock we connected a nozzle. Here the kinetic the potential energy as well as the pressure energy coming from this penstock. So here potential energy is converted to pressure energy, then here the pressure energy is converted as a kinetic energy. So the kinetic energy coming from this nozzle is issues or nothing but the jet of water strikes on a curved shape of bucket. Then what happens? The bucket is try to move away from the jet, then the wheel is rotating. So this wheel is also called as a runner. This is a Pelton wheel. So Pelton wheel is nothing but it is a tangential flow, means the water coming from the nozzle is strikes on a bucket or wheel at the tangent. Means this is a tangent of wheel, means the water is strikes this tangent. That's why this flow is called a tangential flow. That's why the Pelton wheel is a tangential flow impulse turbines. Means here this is completely working on a environment atmosphere, in a constant atmosphere is called, pressure energy is constant. That's why this is called as a pure impulse turbine. That's why the Pelton wheel is nothing but a tangential flow impulse turbine, where the pressure energy and potential energy is converted as a kinetic energy and the converted into a form of high speed of water jet issuing on a coming from the nozzle is strikes on a cupped bucket shaped or hemispherical shape of a bucket. This is a Pelton wheel. So what is the parts and the function of a Pelton wheel? So there are four major parts of the Pelton wheel. The first one is a nozzle and flow regulating arrangement. This is a nozzle and flow regulating valve is nothing but the first part is a nozzle and flow regulating valve is called as a, this is a flow regulating valve is called a spear. And the second one is a runner and buckets. Second one is a runner. This is the first one. Nozzle and spear, both are the nozzle and flow rate mechanism or this device is called spear. And second one is a runner and buckets, also second part, runner and bucket. And third one is a casing and last one is a braking jet. This is a casing, third one, this last one is a braking jet. These are the main four parts. Of course we can explain the penstock also. So these are the major parts. The first one is a nozzle and flow arrangement, or flow regulating arrangement. That for purpose of a flow regulating arrangement we use here the spear, and second one runner and bucket, third one is a casing, fourth one is a nozzle. So these are the main components of a Pelton wheel. So let us explain one by one. So nozzle and flow regulating one, this is a nozzle. This nozzle is connected at the end of penstock for increasing the kinetic energy. Here the nozzle is a divergent shape or reducing cross sectional area. When the area is decreases, kinetic velocity increases, then kinetic energy increases. The kinetic energy coming from this nozzle is strikes on the jet of water. This is called as a jet of water. It strikes on a bucket or cup of a runner or a Pelton wheel turbine. So and here the is long shaped spear is connected. This spear is used for regulating the flow rate or controlling the flow rate of water or to strike the blade or cup of or bucket of a wheel. So the spear mechanism is a to and fro mechanism. When the spear is moves towards right, the flow regulating is the jet of water is or jet velocity is decreases. When it is moves towards backward, the more water is issuing from the nozzle, then high kinetic energy increases. When the spear is moves towards right, means forward direction, towards the forward direction, it's try to closing off or reducing of this cross section area. This means the velocity decreases. Next, this means the kinetic energy will decrease and the flow of water is also decreases. This is the first one, nozzle and flow regulating arrangement, that is called a spear. For a flow regulating arrangement we use a spear. This is a function of a spear. And the second one, so at the end of a spear there is a wheel provided. You can see in this lab, our laboratory, when the wheel is rotating, that spear guide, this spear rod is moves to and fro. When the spear rod is moves towards right, the flow is controlling, means reducing the flow. The spear valve is movements in the backward direction, leftward direction, the flow of water is increases. And second one, runner and bucket. A Pelton wheel consists of a runner. This is a runner. On the outer periphery of the runner, there are a number of buckets is attached, or hinged to the outer periphery of the runner. All of these buckets are equally spaced. These buckets may be this buckets is a shape of a double hemispherical or double elliptical shape. So this is a shape. So this is a double, this is one hemisphere, this is a another hemisphere. So this is the shape of a bucket. So we can write as this one also, double hemispherical shape of this bucket. The blades of the Pelton wheel runner is a double hemispherical or double elliptical shape. And all these buckets are made of cast iron or bronze or stainless steel, depending upon the head available to the Pelton wheel. So these buckets are made of stainless steel or cast iron or bronze. This material is depends on the whatever the head available for this turbine. So and the third one is a casing. The casing is a, this casing is the whole arrangement of runner and bucket and inlet and nozzle are covered. So all these arrangements, spear and nozzle and runner, these buckets or spear bracket, all these are the covered by this casing. So this casing is nothing as a function of hydraulic function of this turbine. So this is not a functional part of this entire unit. This is only for using splashing of water coming from the jet. Means edaithe water dinna strike avutundo ee splashing ante water bayate tullipokunna idi cover chestundi. So casing is nothing but a covering part for spear mechanism and nozzle, runner, brake jet and runner and bucket. So this is not at all having a functional of hydraulic turbine. This is just used for splashing or avoid splashing of jet of water to the remaining parts. So this casing is to prevent splashing of water out of the turbine, and also it is used for the water is goes to the tail race. And last part is braking jet. This braking jet is used to stop or retarding the runner of a Pelton wheel. Means whenever the working of turbine stops, means if you want to stop the entire plant or turbine, we shut down or we close the gate wall of the penstock. So even if you close the gate wall of the penstock, immediately the turbine is not stopped, it's continuous due to inertia of this wheel, this continuously operating. Means it's not suddenly a stoppage of wheel, it's continuously rotating. To stop sudden stoppage of wheel, we are using the braking of a nozzle. So the braking of nozzle here also, the water is coming from this braking of nozzle, and this is strikes on this bucket. So means you observe this, when the water strikes from water coming from the nozzle strikes on the bucket, it's move in this direction, anti-clockwise direction. When the braking jet is, water is coming from here, the water is strikes on this blade, it's try to retard opposite direction. So means this movement, this rotation direction stops due to the striking of a braking nozzle. So this is a function of a braking nozzle. So what is the working of a Pelton wheel? Let us see. So these are the parts are come, what is the different parts we completed, and coming next I will explain the working of a Pelton wheel. So the water is transferred from the high head source through the long conduit is called penstock. So ikkada nunchi vache water edaitundo danni manam penstock antamu. So the nozzle arrangement, the end of nozzle arrangement, the penstock a nozzle arrangement is connected. So this nozzle, the high velocity water is issuing on this bucket. So the water actually the water strikes at the center of the bucket. So this is here the water is strikes on the bucket. So then what happened, the water is strikes on the center of the bucket, then it's moving away from the jet, away from the center as a U-turn. So it is a deflect likes. So generally the water coming from the nozzle as with the angle of 1 to 3 degree. So 1 degree to 3 degree, that is strikes on this bucket, the center of the bucket. So here the water is strikes at the center of the bucket for removing axial thrust. So for removing axial thrust, the water is strikes at the hemisphere, like here. So here the water is strikes the center of the bucket. The bucket is a shaped of a double hemispherical. For this is the striking of this center is used for the removing of axial thrust, reducing the axial thrust, and the water get deflected in this both buckets. this and this. So generally the water get deflected with an angle around 165 to 170 degrees. So the water coming from the nozzle is around 1 degree to 3 degree, and the water leaves from this jet means this bucket around 165 to 170 degrees. This is a approximate value, the deflection. So so then what happened? Whenever the jet strikes in this bucket, it try to move away from the jet, then it will start rotating of a runner. Then this runner mechanism, or this shaft of runner, we connect to the turbine for developing the power. This is a working principle, and you can follow any textbook for this complete information. Now we will go for design aspects of a Pelton wheel. So for designing of a Pelton wheel, we required number of some important parameters. So important aspects of a Pelton wheel. So I already told that the water coming from the nozzle is around the nozzle angle or jet angle is around 1 to 3 degrees. It's almost around 0 degrees, means 1 and 3 degrees is it's look like a almost a straight line, means the water the flow angle almost nearly zero. Then according to velocity triangle, the alpha one is zero. So then beta one is also zero. So generally, so what is the velocity triangle? Already we studied in previous topic. This is a velocity triangle. When the jet strikes here with an angle alpha one or beta alpha one, this is a velocity triangle, this is a beta 1, means this is a velocity triangle, this is alpha 1 and this is beta 1, means if the water strikes with an angle is called alpha 1 with an absolute velocity v1, means the water is striking, this is a double hemispherical, this means the water strikes at the center of the this bucket of a Pelton wheel, means the water angle is almost 0 degrees, means this is a the water striking with the absolute velocity v1 with alpha 1 is equal to 0. When alpha 1 is 0, beta 1 also 0. So this means, so just first I draw the general velocity triangle. If the water absolute velocity coming from the jet is alpha v1 with angle alpha 1, then this is a blade velocity u1 and this is a relative velocity vr1 with an angle beta 1 blade angle, and this is a tangential velocity vw1 or whirl velocity, this is a flow velocity vf1. So the when alpha 1 is 0, means the jet strikes along the with a zero angle, means that strikes a straight line, that v1, so the v1 is collinear on vw1, means v1 is a collinear on vw1. So then this is a converted as a u1, this part is called u1. So the remaining part is vr1, means there is a alpha 1, beta 1 is a 0, means the inlet velocity triangle also is completely as a straight line. So as well as the outlet velocity triangle, you can draw here or here. So this is a outlet triangle. So outlet triangle will be same as a triangle. So this is a vr2, this is a v2, so as well as same in the previous topic. But the Pelton wheel, the inlet velocity triangle almost a straight line. V1 will collinear in vw1, this is u1, then vr1. So this is a some important aspects of a Pelton wheel. So this means, so v1 is collinear in vw1, then vr1 is equal to v1 minus u1 when the alpha 1 and beta 1 will be 0. So the inlet and outlet tips of buckets is almost same, therefore u1 and u2 will be same as a u in a Pelton case. Pelton means the inlet of, means the touch, the water coming from the nozzle strikes at the same center and leaves from the same center, means the then u1 is u2 is same as a u, that is equal to u is equal to pi d n by 60 meters per second. Here d is a diameter of the wheel, n is a number of rotations by the wheel. This is a U. Why U1 is equal to U2 is equal to same means the water strikes at the here and leaves from also here, means at the same radius. If you take as a wheel, it strike. So this is a the water strikes. This is R1. This is a R2. Means the water strikes at here and leaves starting also here. Means R1 is equal to R2. Generally, U is equal to omega into R. U is equal to omega into R. Omega is the angular velocity. Angular velocity of wheel is same. R is same. Then U1. And U2 means initial velocity of blade, outlet velocity of blade, final velocity of blade is same. So then U is equal to pi d n by 6 t. So where d is the diameter of the wheel, n is the number of rotations by the wheel, or d is nothing but a mean depth. So this is an inlet triangle. So I will draw the inlet triangle completely. So the absolute velocity v1 coming with alpha 1 0, then beta 1 also 0. So this is a completely tangential velocity or wheel velocity vw1. So this is a inlet blade velocity u1. This is a vr1. So this is a outlet triangle. This is a outlet triangle. So the angle of deflection, this is a outlet triangle. This is the angle of deflection. This is a relative velocity at exit VR2. This is a V2 with an angle alpha 2. This is a blade angle beta 2, and this is a flow velocity VF2. I cannot draw here. This part is a VW2. This entire part is a U2. So I cannot draw here. There is no space. You can follow my notes. And this is a beta 2. This is an angle of deflection. This is an angle of a deflection completely. So this is a velocity. The outlet velocity triangle may be in a different ways. So the outlet triangle may be slow runner. The outlet velocity angle may be changes according to different directions. If alpha 2 is 90 degrees, if alpha 2 is 90 degrees, already I told in impact of jets, if the alpha 2 is 90 degrees, VW2 will be merged in a VF2. VW2 will be 0. If alpha 2 is less than 90 degrees, this is a velocity angle. If the alpha 2 is greater than 90 degrees, alpha 2 is greater than 90 degrees, so the velocity angle will be so this. So all this, when alpha 2 is 90 degrees, alpha 2 is less than 90 degrees, alpha 2 is greater than 90 degrees, already we derived an impact of jets on concepts. So the runner of when the alpha 2 is less than 90 degrees, that is alpha 2 is less than 90 degrees, that called a slow runner. When the alpha 2 is 90 degrees, that is a medium runner, means it's medium speed. When the alpha 2 is greater than 90, this is a fast runner. So this is a velocity triangles. So there is a another important terms. Okay, we go for important aspects and to design aspects also. So I will discuss one by one. So these are the design aspects. The first one, velocity of the jet. Velocity of the jet. And second one, velocity of the wheel. velocity of the wheel, velocity of jet is called V or V1, velocity of the wheel or blade U, and second, third one, angle of deflection of jet, angle of deflection of jet, and fourth one, mean diameter of wheel, mean diameter of wheel. Next, jet ratio. And bucket dimensions, number of jets, number of jets, number of buckets, discharge from the jet, friction factor. So these are the important design aspects. Some books may be varying around 10, or some books may be written only 5 or 6 important. So let us discuss one by one. So this is the velocity of the water. Formula V is equal to CV into rho 2gh. How this is coming? V is equal to CV into 2gh. This derivation is not required, but if you want how it is coming, V is equal to how we can derive V is equal to CV into rho 2gh, you can follow in my notebook. And velocity of the wheel, we can find out the velocity of V is equal to pi d n by 60 meters per second. So if you know velocity of the wheel, we can find out diameter of the wheel. If you know diameter of the wheel, we can find out the velocity of the wheel. And angle of deflection, angle of deflection we can find out, and mean diameter, that's why U is equal to pi d n by 60 meters per second. And jet ratio, so jet ratio is nothing but m by d, I think so. So jet ratio m is equal to d by d, capital D by small d. Capital D is the diameter of the wheel, small d is the diameter of the jet. Number of jets, so the number of jets we can find out by using a discharge formula. Q is equal to area into velocity. Q is equal to area into velocity. Area is called pi by 4, area of the cross section of the jet or nozzle, pi by 4 d square into velocity. If there is a single jet, there is a pi by 4 d square into, this is a multi jet, number of jets into area of individual cross section of the nozzle into velocity. So by, if we know the discharge, we can find out the number of jets. And the number of buckets, by using Tygen's formula, we can find out the number of buckets. Number of buckets, z is equal to this is a number of buckets formula is derived from Tygen formula. Z is equal to, z is a number of buckets, z is equal to 15 plus d by 2d, 15 plus capital D by small capital D by 2 into small d. D is the diameter of wheel, d is small d is the diameter of the jet, or sometimes we can write as 15 plus d by d is called jet ratio. So we can write as a d by d 0.5 m, because 1 by 2 is a half, 0.5 of a jet ratio. So again, discharge of nozzle, this is also discharge of nozzle or jet. We can follow this formula for number of jets as well as a discharge. And the friction factor, k is equal to, friction factor we can write as a k is equal to Vr2 by relative velocity at exit by relative velocity of inlet triangle. If the bucket is smooth, both relative velocity at exit and inlet is same, means this is a bucket. If this surface, inner surface of bucket is smooth, means there is no roughness, how whatever the jet rate velocity is entered, if the rate velocity is 10 meters per second, if the inside of this bucket is smooth, there is no roughness, means there is no friction factor, thus with the same velocity 10 meters per second water is coming from this this inside of the blade, means this completely this is a smooth. So in this if any problem, if the smoothness or there is no friction, is if the friction factor is not given, the k is equal to 1. If the k is equal to 1 means, if the k is equal to 1 means VR2 is equal to VR1, this means relative velocity at inlet exit should be same. If the bucket is a rough, there is a friction factor. If the friction factor is given except of 1, there should be a VR1 is less than, sorry, VR2 is less than VR1. Means ఇక్కడ ఏదైనా ఫ్రిక్షన్ కానీ ఉందనుకోండి, ఏమవుతుంది, ఇఫ్ ది 10 మీటర్స్ ఆఫ్ వాటర్ అనేది దీంట్లో స్ట్రైక్ అవుతుంది అనుకోండి, ఇక్కడ ఫ్రిక్షన్ కానీ ఉందనుకోండి బ్లేడ్లో, ఏమవుతుంది, డెఫినెట్ ఇక్కడికి వచ్చే వెలాసిటీ అనేది 10 కన్నా ఉండదు, అప్పుడు ఏమవుతుంది, లెస్ దాన్ 10 అవుతుంది, అంటే రిలేటివ్ వెలాసిటీ ఎగ్జిట్లో తగ్గిపోతుంది. సో ద ఫ్రిక్షన్ ఫ్యాక్టర్ 1 మీన్స్ బ్లేడ్ ఈ స్మూత్, అంటే విఆర్ టూ ఈజ్ ఈక్వల్ టు విఆర్ వన్. ఫ్రిక్షన్ ఫ్యాక్టర్ ఎంతో కొంత అదర్ దాన్ 1 ఇచ్చారనుకోండి, డెఫినెట్గా రిలేటివ్ వెలాసిటీ ఎగ్జిట్ ఈజ్ లెస్ దాన్ విఆర్ వన్, బికాస్ హియర్ ద ఫ్రిక్షన్ is generated, the friction is reduces this velocity. So these are the design aspects of a Pelton wheel. Last one, blade efficiency or nozzle efficiency. You can follow my notes. Blade efficiency, the derivation also I will give, it is in my notes. You can follow derivation of blade efficiency. So blade efficiency is nothing but efficiency of blade is equal to output by, so any efficiency of blade is equal to output by input. Output is nothing but runner power RP by input power is kinetic energy coming from the nozzle. So runner power, we know that m dot into VW1 minus U1 into U, m dot into VW1 minus VW2 into U, actually VW1 U1 minus VW2 U2, in Pelton case U1 is equal to U2 is same, that's why U is common here, divided by kinetic energy half mv square. Here also m dot is cancel, after we are getting VW1 minus VW2 into U by half v square, we can write as 2 into v square. So this is a efficiency, v is nothing but initial velocity, that's why v1. So this is a blade efficiency, 2 into vw1 minus vw2 into u by v1 square. You can follow my notes for complete information. And a jet deflection angle, if you want to blade angle, if in the problem jet deflection is given, deflection angle is given in the, if any problem, deflection angle is given, we can found out the blade angle, that is equal to 180 minus deflection angle. This means any problem, if the deflection angle is given as 165 degrees, so generally deflection angle 165 to 170 degrees. If not given in the problem, we can treat it as a 165 degrees as a deflection angle coming from the blade. So if the deflection angle is given in the problem, we can find out the blade angle by 190 minus the deflection angle. So the inlet and outlet triangle, by blade efficiency, we can find out the maximum blade efficiency. Blade efficiency also we can find out by using a blade efficiency, but maximum blade efficiency we need not require for maximum blade efficiency for this conditions, for your chapters. If you want to know about the maximum blade efficiency, you can follow my notebook. There is a derivation for maximum blade efficiency. So I complete all the design aspects, and last one is the efficiencies of the. So for next concepts is efficiencies. So different efficiencies we should learn for calculating our design aspects for turbines and all these things. And the first one is hydraulic efficiency. So the different efficiencies, hydraulic efficiency, hydraulic efficiency, FICI, hydraulic efficiency, we can write as eta H. And second one is a mechanical efficiency, and last one is the overall efficiency. Mechanical efficiency, mechanical efficiency, that is eta M, and the last one is a overall efficiency, eta O. So these are the efficiencies required for in a hydraulic turbines. So what is the hydraulic efficiency, what is the mechanical efficiency, what is the overall efficiency, we should learn. So hydraulic efficiency is nothing but output runner power by water power. So generally, if it is a turbine wheel, this is a blades, so this is a nozzle. So the output means for rotating of the shaft, we called as a output. For getting this output, this rotational energy, we required some input energy, that is equal to nozzle energy, that is equal to kinetic energy. So output energy means for output energy is the rotation of the shaft, means runner power. Input energy, inlet energy is nothing but water power. Water power is nothing but kinetic energy. So runner power by kinetic energy. Runner power we can write as m dot runner power PR by water power. Water power per second. Water power is per second. So water power is nothing but kinetic energy per second. So kinetic energy per second means kinetic energy half m V square per second. So we can write as half into m by s, we can write as m dot mass flow rate and V1 square. So that is equal to, we can write as a m dot, again we can write as a half m dot, we can rho q and V1 square. So overall we can write as a so water power is not a kinetic energy, water power is a potential energy, potential energy per second. Potential energy per second. Potential energy is mgh by second, m by s, mass flow rate per second, mass flow rate by time is equal to m dot into gh, then record as m dot, we can write rho q, then gh. So therefore hydraulic efficiency is the runner power by rho q g rho q gh. So rho q gh we called as a water power. And mechanical efficiency is nothing but shaft power by runner power. So getting of shaft power is a mechanical energy. For getting shaft power, we require the runner power, shaft power by runner power. And overall efficiency we can calculate by using a multiplication of mechanical efficiency as well as a hydraulic efficiency. So overall efficiency we can get as a hydraulic efficiency into mechanical efficiency. Hydraulic efficiency is a runner power by water power, mechanical efficiency is shaft power by runner power. Runner power get cancelled, we got remaining as a shaft power by water power is the overall efficiency. These are the efficiencies: hydraulic efficiency, mechanical efficiency, overall efficiency. Hydraulic efficiency is nothing but runner power by water power. When hydraulic energy strikes on the wheel, we get the runner power is the output energy, that is a water power is input energy. So runner power, water input energy is a potential energy per second. Potential energy is mgh by time second, mgh, m by s, mass flow rate, we can write as m dot gh, m dot we can write as rho q. Already you know, we derived as what is m is equal to rho q, we discussed in the impact of jets, this rho q gh, then runner power by rho q gh. Mechanical efficiency is equal to getting of shaft power is a mechanical power, then for getting of this mechanical output energy, we require the input as a runner power. When the runner is rotating, the shaft of runner is rotating, means shaft of runner is the output, runner is the input, then shaft power by in runner power, then overall efficiency eta O is equal to multiplication of hydraulic efficiency into mechanical efficiency. We get the shaft power by water power. These are the efficiencies of the any hydraulic turbines. So next topic is limitations of Pelton wheel. So what is the limitations of Pelton wheel? So generally Pelton wheel is operating for only high heads. It is not operated it cannot be operated under low heads. Why we cannot operate in low heads? Just let us see. So generally input energy is equal to water power is equal to rho qgh. Water power is equal to rho qgh. So this is equal to water power, rho qgh. So rho is a constant and g is also constant, because rho is a density of water, g is an acceleration due to gravity. Means the power is always proportional to the density of water and discharge of water, acceleration due to gravity of water, and h head available to the turbine. So here rho is density 1000 kg per meter cube, this is a constant, g is equal to acceleration due to gravity. For any turbine, density of water and acceleration due gravity is the same. Therefore it means so for given power, so power is constant, we can take as a constant. So then rho is also constant, then q and h. So qh is equal to constant. For given power, P is equal to, that P is directly proportional to the Q into H. Means Q into H, then by taking QH is equal to constant, then Q is equal to, we can write as 1 by H. So inversely proportional to, means both the discharge and head should be inversely proportional. So generally Pelton wheels operates on a higher heads. It operates on a higher heads. So when the head is high, discharge is always decrease, the discharge value should be very low. So if the Pelton wheel operates on the low head, what happen? So generally the Pelton wheel operates on the higher head, the higher head low discharge is required, it's enough. If the Pelton wheel operates on the low heads, so when the head on the turbine is decreases, means when the turbine on the head is decreases, definitely the Pelton wheel should be operated on the low heads. So what happened if the Pelton wheel on the turbine operates, the Pelton wheel operates on low heads, means if the head is decreases, what should be increases? Q should be increases. Why? Q is equal to constant. If head is decreases, for maintaining same constant power, we should increase the Q. Am I right? For example, if the head is a 5, discharge is a 2, 2 into 5 is a 10. If the head is decreases, means if it is converted into 2, what happened? Discharge should be 5 for maintaining the same 10. This is a functional. Is it clear? For getting a 10 kilowatt power, 10 units of power, under 5 units of head, we should do 2 units of discharge. For maintaining same discharge, when head is decreases as a 2, what happened? discharge should be increases. So what happened if the discharge is increases? So we know that discharge is equal to, means when Pelton wheel operated low heads, discharge should be increases. So therefore discharge Q is equal to, for more discharge Q is equal to pi by 4, discharge is equal to area into velocity, area is equal to pi by 4 d square into v. For increasing of, so when the Pelton wheel operate on low heads, it require high discharge. For maintaining high discharge, whether we can increase the velocity of the water or diameter of the water, either by increasing the D, either by increasing the V, we can increase the Q. But increasing the higher velocity is always not possible. So there is only one chance, increasing the diameter. So increasing of diameter, what happen? Diameter of nozzle is increases. Means that the diameter of nozzle, this diameter of nozzle is increases. So when the diameter of nozzle is increases, high amount of jet of water is deflected on the bucket. So for withstand this high amount of jet of water, the jet dimension also, means the blade dimension should also very high. When the blade dimension is high, wheel dimension is also high. So what happened? The system is bulky, means overall Pelton wheel is increases more size. More the sizes is nothing but more the weight of the wheel. More the weight of the wheel, again efficiency will be decreases. So that's why Pelton wheel is operates always in a higher head. So higher head requires a low discharge. If the Pelton wheel is operates in low head, discharge should be increased. For increasing discharge, we should increase the diameter of the nozzle. When the diameter of nozzle increases, the jet coming from the nozzle is very high. For withstanding the high amount of jet, the blade dimension should increases. If the blade dimension increases, the wheel diameter also, wheel dimensions also increases. When the wheel dimensions increases, more the weight of the wheel, more the weight of the wheel, again lesser will be the efficiency of the Pelton wheel. That's why the Pelton wheel should not operate in the low heads. Thank you.